then for like which peers working with one NGO, then now that NGO we had a collaborative research project. I mean, the idea of that NGO's research came from the Aga Khan Foundation, so as some of you may know it. Then, the NGO's, you know, idea of, you know, data collection, you know, like, all came from, not only from India, but also from developed countries such as, you know, the US, you know, like the World Bank in there, then the United Kingdom, you know, where, you know, development studies as an institution, you know, has flourished. Then, well, I must tell you that, well, I would say I'm one of the few who came to India for a higher degree to get to know about international development. Well, from Japan, like, you know, those who are interested in international development normally go to Europe, like such as, you know, England or the Netherlands, and some also go to, you know, the United States. But then, you know, like they study international development and public policy. Then, you know, they do visit developing countries, you know, like for investigation for several months at the longest. Then, you know, like they try to combine, you know, Western bond theories with their field, you know, data. Then, you know, like they keep publishing things. But I didn't like that idea, but, you know, I really wanted to know, you know, like what the practice of sociology and anthropology would be in India. So that, you know, from the ground, you know, from the bottom up, I thought, you know, like I could contextualize my theoretical insights with, you know, field realities. And my second aim is to examine the ground in which fieldwork using participatory methods can open up space for poor people themselves. I mean, I was talking about, you know, self-interest-driven, you know, practice of fieldwork, you know, on the part of that NGO and on the part of myself, you know, as a young researcher who was trying to establish his career, you know, like in Japan, without, you know, not just, you know, PhD thesis, but we also need to have, you know, some refereed articles in established journals in order that, you know, we get a job. Then, well, I would say I applied for over 60 or 70 positions, you know, in Japan and in Britain. I would say I got shortlisted for three positions in the UK, but I couldn't get all of them. And I got shortlisted for one, two, three, probably three, four. Yeah, four positions in Japan. Then, you know, like I had to struggle as a poor PhD or postdoctoral researcher. But anyway, but, you know, like I needed to, you know, like exploit, you know, like local people. I needed to exploit, you know, local NGOs for, you know, arranging my fieldwork, you know. Then before, you know, arranging my fieldwork, you know, I had to apply for, you know, research grants, you know, from the Japanese government. Then I have to say something very nice. You know, for example, in Japan, like, you know, and in many other, say, developed countries, quantification of research is the prime concern of, you know, social researchers. And, you know, of course, you know, sociologists, you know, do conduct, you know, qualitative research, but, you know, like, they do not really focus on participatory research. But I said, you know, I conduct, you know, participatory research for my investigation when I was applying for a research grant. I mean, this, by doing, you know, participatory research, I say, you know, I would aim to include those, you know, slum journals for my investigation so that, you know, I could work in with them on an equal ground. It wasn't so, anyway. So it was a, you know, kind of... I was almost cheating, you know, the assessors of the granting organization. And my third aim is to explore the poor people's agency by interrogating the disjunction between the intended outcome of ethnography. For example, you know, I mean, this, I have talked as if, you know, those poor people are small people, but the
trying to look at, you know, like the intentions of my research and the intention of, you know, my partnering NGOs, you know, in coming to those in the areas, then they're trying to find out, you know, like benefits, you know, that they could tap into, you know, through the cooperation, you know. So then one point is, well, ethnography or, you know, participatory kind is quite, you know, pretty much, you know, globalized. Well, I would say globalization involves, you know, not just, you know, like a time-space compression, but, you know, well, we tend to have, you know, some nodes of, you know, actors, like, for example, like myself being a researcher from the global node, then, you know, my partnering NGO in Ahmedabad, you know, as an agent, you know, from the global south, then, you know, our inspiration or ideas for research came from the World Bank, for example. I mean, during the early 2000s, you know, it is the World Bank which was collecting, you know, like some more participatory political data from, you know, like many NGOs across the global south, so that, you know, the World Bank, you know, could, what you call, publish, you know, like some, you know, participatory, you know, political, you know, important groups on, you know, moving out of poverty, you know, like poverty profiles. Then, you know, that NGO and I adopted that, you know, method. Well, then, well, that says, you know, the idea came from, you know, the United States of America, you know, the World Bank. Then the Aga Khan Foundation in the UK, then, you know, the idea came from that part as well. So then, in the end, you know, I felt, you know, like I got, you know, distracted from, you know, this rich tradition of, you know, Indian sociology and anthropology. But, you know, I was trying to, you know, generate, you know, qualitative data within a short period of time. So then the end result was that, you know, like, well, there were repercussions from the slum dwellers. So that's the basic idea. And, you know, like, well, I have talked, you know, I did publish, you know, a piece on this topic, actually, as a book chapter. So if you're interested, so I could share with you. So then, theoretically speaking, well, I have looked at, you know, like, two different streams. One is, you know, global ethnography. Again, you know, like, which has, you know, evolved, you know, in the United States. I mean, this, you know, those sociologists who are interested in globalization studies, they have talked about, you know, the politics of getting involved in research, you know, in a different country. And then they have also talked about, you know, what they call the multi-sided ethnographies. For example, like, you know, some researchers, you know, working on international migration. You know, like they have followed, you know, particular informants, you know, like who are moving from one country to another, then, you know, like to another country. Then, you know, like they are trying to, you know, figure out, you know, the positions of those migrants in a given environment. But, you know, my focus was that, you know, like how the idea, or, you know, like how the ideas and theories, you know, get instilled in project implementations of, you know, non-governmental organizations or, you know, like a institution in the global south. That, you know, like we can never, you know, negate, you know, from Western, you know, kinds of ideas in doing, you know, field work domestically. So, and, you know, like the other stream of research has been done by anthropologists, you know, again, not in India, but, you know, like those protagonists are, you know, based in the UK, so development anthropologists. And they do talk about, you know, positionality of researchers, for example. I mean, this, well, anthropology, you know, has been very much, you know, sensitive to the positionality of a researcher, you know, like since so many decades. But, you know, the recent focus is given on what you call the institutionalized position of the researcher. You know, this what kind of agenda you know, he or she has, you know, back home in terms of you know like this for what purpose you know they have to generate data, then you know like what maybe the goal you know, for them, you know, like to you know, like data to publish pieces. So I mean this so from that you know perspective, you know, they try to look at the gap between this you know researchers' intentions and the reception of you know the informants. I think you know that's quite important. And again, it's you know I would you know, repeat it. Well, such relationships you know are you know framed you know, in the context of you know like the globalization of knowledge. So well, we tend to talk about you know global sociology tends to talk about the, or what we call the globalization of human flows, or you know the globalization of you know culture and media. But you know, like well, I really you know just suggest that you know, we need to you know focus you know more upon you know the globalized global flow of you know like ideas and you know knowledge. So well, indeed, my name is Dr. Dawson. Do you teach the sociology of development?
We do, yes.
Okay.
It's usually got in most sociology departments.
I see. There's a Center for Studies in
Sociology departments teach in many places.
Okay. I see. The sociology of development is one of the very minor subdisciplines of sociology in Japan, unfortunately. But anyway, but I think you know, like we cannot you know negate from the talk of you know development when we study you know, sociology. And you know, like I'm slightly deviating from my main topic, but you know, in Japan, like in you know like, North America, fields in the global south, like India, are considered to be the field you know for anthropologists, and you know. And Western Europe, Japan, South Korea, North America are considered to be the domain of you know, sociologists. Because you know, like our sociologists you know, tend to assume that you know, civil society exists in the global world. And you know, like something more, you know, we don't say uncivilized any longer, but you know, like some sociologists, you know, like they're not really aware of you know, like what's going on in the South. I mean, this, they do not pay due attention to the effects of globalization, you know, like due to the flow of, you know, like money, I mean, this migrants, ideas, and theories, you know, from the global north to the global south. Then, you know, like, therefore, you know, like, they still regard, you know, the global south as a field of anthropology, which is, you know, I find, you know, it's quite stupid. So, but anyway, so I have talked about the idea of globalization, you know, like a bit briefly. But you know, like for me to explore the idea of you know, like research practice in the context of globalization, I mean, this I'd like to bring up, you know, like one key theme on the have you heard, you know, like the interpretive community. Like, you know, we interpret, you know, certain things. So, so interpretive community, is, which is comprised of, say, you know, researchers, development agencies, and NGOs. Then, I mean, this, the aim of, you know, like, NGOs and development agencies is to you know provide you know certain services to the needy, and the aim of you know like academic researchers is to generate data you know, for their own publications. Then you know once these you know like different actors you know join together for a project, you know like well the kind of you know like result or kind of you know what you call information we generate, you know, like, can be one-sided, I think. I mean, that is very true to me. I mean, this, when I was working with the local NGO in Ahmedabad,
I was constantly, you know, encouraged to say something very positive about, you know, their investigation in the slum areas. Then, I mean, at the same time, of course, you know, I was looking at, you know, like pros and cons. Yeah, but, you know, like my, what do you call, critical, you know, feedbacks, you know, were not that appreciated. But, you know, I was supposed to generate, you know, the data, you know, that they really want to listen to. So then, you know, when it comes to, you know, like we tend to talk about, you know, the success or the failure of a development intervention. And this is one of the fierce criticisms I received from my PhD supervisor. You know, I say the failure, I say the success in my PhD thesis. And my sir, you know, he asked me, he said, Yutaka, look, you know, like, what do you mean by success? What do you mean by failure? Then I was really encouraged to look at the unintended consequences of action. You know, I mean, this well, of course, you know, I'm not saying that, you know, like those NGOs are, you know, doing all bad, but, you know, like they do have a good will, and they do try to what do you call it, uplift, you know, the living standards of those, you know, slum dwellers. Yes, but you know, like they have certain belief. And then they have certain belief, then, you know, like they have, you know, acquired certain knowledge, you know, from, you know, like their partners, you know, like domestically and internationally. Then, you know, at the end of the day, they have to produce, you know, their own reports, you know, like we have done, you know, this work and that, you know, project. Then, you know, like we have identified, you know, this, you know, what we call the socio-economic profiles of our beneficiaries. You know, such and such ways, then, you know, like they try to say that, you know, like their projects have been, you know, have been, you know, this have generated, you know, like some success, you know, even though they encounter, you know, grudge against them, you know, from their beneficiaries. So then, you know, like this is what actually happened, you know, to my field investigation. So then, you know, well, I'd like to this will bring up, you know, like another, you know, like the topic of reflexivity. Do you teach reflexivity? Yeah, I mean, this, we are bound to be reflexive upon, you know, like what we have done. For example, please allow me to deviate from the topic, but, you know, I myself is from Fukushima in Japan. Yeah, this, in 2011, you know, this, if you remember, they will say, you know, the leakage of nuclear, you know, my parents' home is located about, you know, 60 kilometers away from the, what you call, nuclear power stations. Then, well, my parents are, well, you know, they're in their 70s, and, you know, like, they say they have nothing to lose. Then, you know, for a few years, you know, they relinquished, you know, home gardening, but, you know, they restarted some years ago. Then, you know, that, you know, incident, that incident, you know, really compelled, you know, many Japanese to think carefully about the benefits of science, the benefits of technology. You know, like here in India, you know, many people have told me, you know, that Japan is a country of technology. Yeah, well, maybe because I need to give another, you know, like a talk on that, you know, like Japan was very lucky, you know, like to develop, you know, like technologically. I mean, because Japan was never colonized, so that's one of the very simple reasons. But anyway, so I have talked about, you know, what I call possible, you know, risks of, you know, science and technology. And, you know, like, even within the development community, like, you know, we tend to follow, you know, certain ideas, you know, as what they call almighty, you know. Okay, so this idea came from the World Bank, this idea came from, you know, this Institute of Development Studies in Sussex University, which is the largest, you know, like, institution in international development.
But yeah, you know, just wait. Just, you know, we need to think very carefully about, you know, like how they have, you know, generated, you know, like such understandings of, you know, development, science, technology, I mean, everything. Then, well, then, you know, like participatory research is one of the techniques, you know, that we have, you know, developed. Then I do not really see it as almighty, but, you know, people do. As I said, you know, like when we, you know, make an application for research grant, you know, if we say, okay, this we will, you know, conduct, you know, participatory research by, you know, encouraging, you know, like our informants' participation. Then, you know, like this sounds very good to the assessors, you know. I mean, this without any critical, you know, thought on, you know, like what you want to bring about. So, excuse me. So I said, you know, this I was expected to generate, you know, like a qualitative data, you know, like, which could please, you know, my partnering NGO. Then, and I thought, you know, like I was quite, you know, dissatisfied, you know, with that kind of expectation. Okay. Then, well, I was lucky enough to be a student in India because I had the chance to, you know, learn a bit, you know, like Hindi, little bit of, you know, spoken Hindi. So my spoken Hindi is not enough for, you know, anthropological investigation, not at all. But at least, you know, like I could cross-check, you know, like what conversation, you know, like is going on. Then, you know, I could, you know, like check, you know, whether my research assistants are translating, you know, like the things, you know, correctly or not. Then not only that, but also, you know, I alone visited my research areas. And in the beginning of my personal visits, those, you know, informants were so skeptical about, you know, my personal visits, you know, like they were trying to look at my ulterior motives. Yeah, then, you know, like I again, you know, repeatedly I visited, you know, like two or three slum areas. And then of course, you know, like my, what you call, depth of interaction was not that deep, but, you know, at least, you know, I was lucky in the context, I was lucky in another context because I had my wife, I mean, this is my wife, you know, this was also studying in JNU, I mean, linguistics, not sociology. And, you know, before and after marriage, you know, this, she used to visit me now and about. Then both of us used to go to, you know, my research areas because, well, I would say my wife is fluent in Hindi. She's not an Indian. She's a South Korean. She's very fluent in Hindi. Then, you know, not only this, but also, you know, she's a woman. Well, this what you call that, you know, this wife and husband, you know, combination, you know, like can make, you know, field investigation even better. You know, like that's what, you know, even M.N. Universe, you know, says, you know, in his book, you know, titled, you know, The Field Worker and the Field. So he talks about that as well. Then, you know, like, well, that really worked for me. Then, you know, like slowly, you know, like some of our importance started expressing, you know, like what you call their unmet, you know, desires, you know, for the NGO involvement, you know, like they really demanded this and that, but, you know, like that NGO was, you know, what you call really bound to what you call scaling up, you know, its project, you know, like sites and its project, you know, like fields. So then, you know, that NGO's in project, you know, like would typically finish, you know, within say 1.5 years, 2 years. Then, you know, like those slum dwellers, you know, felt betrayed, you know, like in some way or the other. Then we all, you know, listened to their narratives, then, you know, came to know the gap, you know. Then they
those informants really urged me, not to be involved in such what you call power game, but they really demanded me to come back to their place often. Before anything for chat, for chai, nasta, they always welcomed us so that they could keep outsiders, contact from outsiders. Whereas, previously, they were almost detached from the community of the middle class, the community of different types of people, because those people are educated in government schools, some of them have never been educated, then their occupations are confined in the informal sector. Okay, so they may be working, under the supervision of some rich people, but normally, their daily wages, then, they have their own, world. Then, having criticized, that NGO, I have really identified the unintended consequence of that NGO's action, as well as, my field investigation. Because, our intervention had opened their eyes to external world. Then, those people, became so, bit more demanding. They started expressing, their rights. Their rights to receive, public services. Their rights to be recognized. Recognition is, one important component of poverty. Or moving up to poverty. So then, so in that context, as a field researcher, I need to be more decided in terms of judgment of the project or research. Here I'm not going to judge, any outcome. I'm not going to classify, which one, has been successful and which one has been, failure. But, different actors, have different logics, but, I'm trying to delineate, the social logics of each actor so that, we can look at what you call in such unintended consequences. Then, the final thing, I'd like to tell you is that in terms of globalization, engagement in public policies has kept increasing.
then those NGOs, you know, used to be, you know, like a standalone, you know, social movements, you know, that can include, you know, women's movements, or, you know, trade union movements, you know, like their movements, you know, used to occur at the workplace, you know, mostly. But, you know, their fields of action, you know, shifted from, so to say, like, you know, trade unionism to, you know, like more locality, neighborhood-based, you know, like places. I mean, this, then, you know, like their partners, you know, became government agencies, sometimes international researchers. Then, you know, like this means, this implies that, you know, those NGOs actually, you know, has become, you know, like more, what do you call it, you know, has become, you know, like a shorter in terms of, you know, time frame than before. I mean, this, when we emerge in social movements, you know, like, we expect, you know, like some more, you know, concerted action initiated by, you know, like actors themselves, you know, like actors in terms of, you know, poor people, poor women, informal sector workers. But when it comes to, you know, NGO intervention, you know, like, well, we can imagine this, you know, like some more vertical relations, you know, between, you know, like the implementers and the recipients. Then, you know, obviously the flow of, you know, information, the flow of knowledge, you know, is, tends to become, you know, one-sided. So then I was, you know, doing my research in that context, you know, that, you know, I need to be really reflexive upon, you know, what I have done. And then when it comes to, you know, writing, you know, these articles, I'm also, you know, like, I tend to be very, very apologetic. Being aware of, you know, like such, what you call a global, you know, like a global politics of intervention. So, yeah, so I think I have talked, you know, like about this most of my, you know, this point. So I shall end my talk here. Talk about the other part. Yeah, then I'd like to receive your questions.
Do you want to make it also interactive?
Please go ahead.
Hold it open and...